Gold Squadron fans, welcome to the Chicagoland Regional Championship 2017. I guess it's the season of 2016-2017.
That's right.
We're coming live from Pastimes in Niles. I'm Darwin Schaefer, and beside me...
I'm Johnny Randazzo.
Better known as Rage, and I'll go by the call sign Predator for all you guys out there. We have 120 players in today's regional. Big event going on. The store is packed. If you hear a lot of noise in the background, we're mic'd and we have a mic on the table, so you might hear some background noise. But yeah, exciting day, huh, Johnny?
Yeah, I'm excited to be here. There's a ton of people here, a really good crowd, and we'll be here streaming all day.
All day today and all day tomorrow for the top 16. It's going to be an exciting event. You can watch them live. You can watch them later on YouTube, whatever you want to do. So let's talk about our first matchup.
All right.
So we not so randomly have selected, since everyone's 0-0 right now.
That's
we have Lyle Hayhurst, who is Pastimes' reigning store champion. Lyle actually flew in from Portland, Oregon today to play. He moved away in the last year and thought he wanted to come back just to defend his store champion title. Great player, one of the best. He's been playing since wave one.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of experience there. Obviously, has a lot of experience on the competitive scene. And so, you know, playing casually and playing in tournaments, a lot of times it's a different animal. And having that experience and being able to handle the pressure, that can bring you a long way.
Absolutely. Really great player. I don't think in all my time of playing against him, I ever beat him.
Yeah, I've never had the pleasure to play against him, but I've been following him for a long time. And, yeah, this should be a good matchup here.
I had the opportunity in the second to last round of the Hoth Open. We were both undefeated, and he gave me my first and only defeat.
All right.
So let's talk about the other player, Jake Hanek. He's a local here, not a Pastimes player. He's in the 147th Attack Squadron, plays in Fair Game and lives in Downers Grove. I met him before. Good guy. Yeah, obviously we got a lot of good players in this area, Johnny.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, people are coming from all over the Chicago area and all over the country, and even some international people flying in just for this tournament. So, yeah, we'll see people from all over the place. Really high skill level here. Should be a great day.
Absolutely. And when you said internationally, it made me think, for those of you that haven't maybe seen the post, we actually have Paul LaRue from Canada playing in our tournament today. He's going to be playing today and then signing autographs tomorrow. So you are absolutely right. International presence.
That's right.
So we're going to go ahead and go to the live stream now, and let's take a look and talk about some of these lists, Johnny.
All right, so we have Lyle flying the so-called Paratani list. It's been getting a lot of popularity over the past few regionals. This list consists of Fenrau, Asajj Ventress, and Manaru, all with a Tani Mind Link. So they're able to pass those focus tokens for some action efficiency. And obviously with Manaru being in there as a support ship, she can pass focus tokens to anyone and still get that focus back with a Tani Mind Link. So very powerful list. It acts as a counter to a lot of other popular lists out there. You get a little bit of control with Asajj, being able to pass stress tokens, or being able to hand out stress tokens, or use Lats Razi to remove those stress tokens and get an extra evade. So also a very difficult list to push damage through and be able to take down.
In my opinion, Johnny, this list is just nasty. I've had the opportunity to fly against it a couple times, and it's great. I think it's going to be a strong showing. I wouldn't be surprised if not necessarily Lyle, but this list shows up in the top eight or top four, even better here. I know personally, it's a question of who do you attack. No matter which ship you're going after, the other two are wrecking you. If you try to chase Manaru down, you're just going to get blown up. And if you let Manaro do her thing, Asajj and Fenn are going to take. They're going to work you. So really, really a strong list here. We'll see how it goes for Lyle today. And on the other side, we got Jake. Jake's going to be flying Dash. Dash has Lone Wolf, the typical heavy laser cannon with the title, and Ray on board. And then he's bringing along two Gold Squadron pilots, both with TLTs. Thoughts on this list, Johnny?
Well, Dash has been around for a long time, always a heavy hitter with that heavy laser cannon, and being able to shoot it 360 degrees obviously can push a ton of damage through. With Ray, you're giving yourself extra focus tokens, to be able to modify that attack. And then TLT. TLT, ever since that card was released, has been around making the rounds. And so this list is just a list of consistent damage. That heavy laser cannon and those TLTs are going to be able to push damage through every single turn. And really going to put Lyle on a clock. If Lyle doesn't fly carefully, he could find himself just in a bad position and taking a lot of damage very quickly.
I absolutely agree. And I think that TLTs right now in this meta are good. You know, I know there's a lot of hate for TLTs out there and people don't want to play against it, but I think right now TLTs really will hold their own in today's meta, especially if some Wave 10 stuff shows up. You know, we should talk about that for our listeners. Wave 10 dropped 2 days ago?
That's right.
And it is, according to FFG, fully legal for today's non-formal level tournament?
Yeah.
Casual level tournament?
I'm looking out at the tables. I am seeing some Upsilon shuttles out there. I'm not sure if there are any quad jumpers. Or any of Sabine's tie, but we'll see as the day goes on if those ships show up. But the one that everyone seems to be talking about is the Upsilon shuttle. That seems to be what everyone's sort of getting ready for.
I flew that myself last night in the warm-up tournament. Can't say I did so well with it, but I had a lot of fun.
Well, it'll be interesting to see how the new lists fare against these lists that have been around for the past few weeks, like the Paratani list, and see if they're going to act as a counter or if they're going to suffer from maybe not a lot of people having experience flying them.
We will hopefully see that in our matches coming up, but for right now it looks like just Wave 9 and below, and this nothing new in this matchup right now.
No, but still going to be a very good matchup. And, you know, Dash, you don't see Dash that much in the tournament scene lately, so it'll be interesting to see how Jake flies him. Again, with that HLC, he has the ability to push a lot of damage through, so I think this will be a good matchup to see. And it's going to be our first taste of the Paratani list here at the Chicago Regional, a list that's been showing up all over the place recently.
I completely agree with you here. It's definitely going to be a good matchup. What do you think the keys to victory here are, Johnny? I mean, what does Lyle got to do? Go straight after Dash?
I'm not sure. Dash has a lot of HP to chew through, and Dash has the Lone Wolf upgrade, which will make them kind of hard to take down. Honestly, you might be better off going for one of those Gold Squadron pilots and just focus firing and being able to take one of those guys out quickly.
And stop the TLT blood coming in.
Yeah, another important thing here is going to be to control range. So both of these pilots, Dash and the Gold Squadron pilot, they have a donut hole at range one. So if you can fly in and get into range one and shut off their either heavy laser cannon or twin laser turret, that's going to take shots away from Jake. So if Lyle's really able to control range and really disrupt Jake's plan, I think he'll be successful here.
You know, now that you mentioned that, Fen is going to be something Jake probably didn't want to see. You know, the PS9, you know, barrel roll boost, it wants to be in range one. Fen wants to be in the donut hole here. So, yeah, I think it's going to take skillful flying for Jake to control the range band like you talked about.
Absolutely. And on Jake's side, if he can kind of control range of his own, keep himself at range three, be able to plink damage onto Asajj or Manaru, take them out quickly, then I think the tides will be in his favor.
All right, looks like we have the shaking of the hands, the nice formal gesture here in X-Wing. Seems like we're always friends here, no matter how the games go, so good to see that.
That's right, and fly casual, all right?
Fly casual.
Then Brandon ran around the table with Dash Radar, so they all he was chasing a guy.
Because I had the wrong guy on the wrong ship. Because I was looking down, I'm like, this isn't the right. Oh, that's the problem.
So Jake's going to go ahead and start slow here. Definitely slow playing, doing what Rebels do best, one forwards. And Lyle starts the same way.
Jake and Lyle.
Yep.
Thank you.
Yeah, so both players are kind of starting out slowly, seeing what the other player is going to do. Like I said, controlling range is going to be a key for both players. Lyle wants to control range to keep Fenrau in the best position possible. And Jake is going to want to control range as well to be able to take full advantage of his secondary weapons, the heavy laser cannon and the twin laser turret. So both of them are kind of jockeying for position right now and seeing when the best moment is going to be to swoop in and take advantage of that range.
One of the things I think is kind of interesting with Lyle's start is he's actually got Manaru pointed towards the middle of the board, pointed towards going forward. You know, you see a lot of players that play Manaru starter, you know, way far in a corner, maybe pointed away from the center of the board just to keep her out of the combat. I personally think this is a good decision. I think it's one of those things that there's a sweet spot with Manaru. You don't want to leave her out of the combat the entire time because she can help. Even though it's just a two-dice turret, it can help. But at the same time, you don't want Manaru to be coming straight in and getting blown up either. I mean, that just cripples this list if Manaru dies early.
So people draw a lot of comparisons between Manaru and the shuttle with Palpatine. Obviously, it acts as a support ship, but it can still take shots. It can still do damage. So being able to, like you said, strike that balance between protecting Manaru and keeping her as a support and actually effectively using her turret and her attack dice to be able to push damage through.
So those Y-Wings are pretty far away from combat right now. He went one straight in this last one. I wonder if he's going to speed up the Y-Wings and try to at least get past that debris field and turn in. Definitely got some rocks in the middle of the board, which doesn't look good for Jake, per se. But Dash doesn't really care about debris, but he doesn't want to end up sitting on one of those rocks when it comes to the combat phase.
That's true. I think with the Y-Wings here, Jake might be planning to flank a little bit, maybe get around that first debris field and kind of come in from the side to take some shots on Lyle's ships. But we'll see. We'll see what he ends up doing in the next few turns, if he's going to try to come in from the side or just kind of go in directly to be able to push damage through.
Looks like the dials are set. A little bit faster this time. Looks like a two straight with the Y. And same thing for the other one.
Yeah, so again, it looks like he's really trying to get around that debris a little bit, but still controlling range, trying to feel out where Lyle's going to end up and be able to push towards the center of the board or just fly around the edges and take TLT shots as he sees fit.
So Manaru turns in here to the middle. And, you know, there I was, you know, again, Lyle surprises me here. You know, most players, I would have seen a barrel back towards the back side of the board with Manaru, keep her out of the combat, but not here.
No, and of course, when she takes that focus action, the entire squad gets focus tokens. So that's another consideration to have her focus rather than do any other action and pass that focus off to the rest of the squad.
Absolutely. Gotta love that Atani Mind Link.
It's great. It's a really powerful card. I think people were slow to adopt it. It didn't see a lot of play when it was first released, but shortly afterwards, you started seeing a lot more Atani Mind Link lists. And this Paratani list has been having a lot of success taking advantage of Atani Mind Link. And obviously with Manaru being able to pass focus tokens, but still...
And get it back.
Get it back. Huge action efficiency. And I think that's one of the keys to why this list has been so successful.
Is there a limit? You can just go all the way around.
Yeah.
So Dash took a right turn, or a right bank. Possibly we might see another bank or a hard turn coming around. He doesn't have engine upgrade on Dash, which is something I'm used to seeing on Dash.
Yeah, that surprised me a little bit, but if he's able, it looks like he's actually trying to maybe drag Lyle through the asteroids a little bit. because he knows that Dash doesn't so much care about the obstacles, and the TLTs, you know, being a turret, can still effectively push damage. So he might be just trying to lure Lyle in through those asteroids on the far side of the board.
I agree, and having to fight in the asteroids is also going to help him control that range band that we talked about earlier. Fenn's going to have less opportunity to do the barrel and boosting shenanigans.
Yeah, that's absolutely right. And with the dial on Asajj, you know, these Lancer class fighters,
they're fast.
They like to go fast. They have 3s, 4s, and 5s that are all green, and so Asajj can get in there really quick. You see that she's kind of angled to go right between those two debris fields. You might see a fast maneuver here and see Asajj really start to take shots on Jake's ships.
It always kind of bewilders me when a large base ship goes 5 straight. That's like half the board.
Exactly, yeah. It goes really far, and you know, it can jump on you really unexpectedly. If you're you think you've got the distance, but then they do that 5 straight, and they're right up there, right in your face. So that's something that you've got to watch out for.
One of the things we can't tell right now is which way the mobile firing arc is pointed on Asajj. My gut tells me, because Lyle started it on the right side of the board, the mobile firing arc's probably in his left quadrant. But we don't know that because based on the angle of the camera. But what it makes me think is, you know, we're talking about a fast maneuver here. Asajj wants to circle you. You know, if that firing arc's to the left, and we've seen other players do this before, but if Asajj can go fast here and let the Y-Wing and Dash get kind of in the middle of those three rocks, Asajj can kind of just circle around the backside and always keep that firing arc to the left, dealing out those stresses and taking shots.
Yeah, Asajj can do the 3 hard turn, which is green, and like you said, just circle around, keeping the mobile firing arc pointed at the opposing ships. Still able to give out stress tokens with Asajj's pilot ability, and able to take shots with a 3 dice primary attack, which can definitely be effective.
And here come the Y-Wings banking into the board. Looks like a 2 bank. Is he going to do a 3 bank with the outside Y-Wing? Nope. Stick with the 2. Another thing I find interesting what Jake's doing, and you know, this will probably unfold differently than I'm seeing right now, is he's got Lone Wolf on Dash, but yet he's kind of flying his ships in formation. It almost feels like Dash wants to be out, but, you know, we'll see how it works out for him. He is going slow with those Y-Wings. We'll see, maybe Dash kind of takes off here and gets separated from the pack.
Yeah, it's tricky because you want to focus fire, obviously. If you can get all 3 of those ships shooting at the same enemy ship, that's going to be the most effective way to take ships off quickly.
Particularly if you get the opportunity in a mana root, right?
Yeah, definitely. Being able to take mana root out would definitely hinder this Paratani list. But at the same time, like you said, you have Lone Wolf. Maybe you want a little bit of separation. But at the very least, Lone Wolf is going to be effective if Dash is the only one left on the board. And will make this list harder to finish off if it gets to that point.
So we were, at least I was wrong with Asajj. He went slow with Asajj again. Really making Jake, you know, they're both playing the same game. Neither of them want to fly into the asteroids here, making the other one make the first move. They're going to run out of space soon, though.
They're getting close. The tension is building. Shots will be fired soon. But right now they're both really trying to control the position and play the distance game, trying to feel the other one out.
So later in the show, hopefully between games, so our viewers know, we're going to try and take a look at the all the squad sheets that came in, and maybe after our lunch break, try to give some information about kind of what the meta here is, since this is the first major tournament with Wave 10. So hopefully we're going to give you an update. We're going to try and break it down by number of Rebel, Imperial, and Scum lists, and also talk a little bit about most popular ships and the factions and such. So stay tuned for that, and we'll hopefully be bringing that to you later in the day. That came to my mind as I look across at the table that you guys on the camera can't see. That's actually right next to our Twitch booth. Seeing five defenders and the new shuttle on the table.
That's right.
Still so some defender love out there.
Definitely, defenders are definitely well represented here, and flying them with the new Upsilon shuttle, it looks like a very powerful list. We'll see if we can see how those lists are doing or get one on the stream later. I think everyone kind of wants to see how that's going to go.
I suspect we'll see a defender at some point during the day on the stream.
Statistically speaking, there's a very high chance of that.
So Lyle moves Fenn in and then Barrel to the back side of the board. Again, trying to control that range combat. And you know, it's important for Fenn because with auto thrusters on, range 3 is not so bad. Obviously, you want to be in range 1. Where Fenn doesn't want to end up is range 2.
Yeah, range 2 is definitely where it's the most dangerous for Fenn. His pilot ability and the Concorde Dawn Protector title kick in at range 1, and auto thrusters kicks in at range 3. Range 2 is dangerous, and on a ship with only 4 hull, taking damage is definitely a dangerous proposition for Fenn Rao.
Fenn dies at range 2, so we'll see if it happens here.
And so it looks like Lyle is spreading his ships out a little bit here. You have Asajj kind of coming around towards the middle of the board, Fenn towards the edge of the board, and Manaru sitting right there in the middle. It'll be interesting to see if they kind of reconverge to be able to focus fire a little bit, or if he's going to keep them spread out to kind of keep more arcs on pointing in as many directions as he can.
This is a big planning stage here. You know, this is the one where you start thinking, okay, my opponent might do this, so I should do this, but he might think I'm doing this, and then he's going to do this, and this is the big one.
Yeah, obviously, the engagement is coming pretty soon. Both of these players have been flying very carefully so far, but they're both trying to sort of vie for position and get that advantage to get the first round of fire to go in their favor.
Jake had his two Y-wing dials set, and they were the only ships set on the board so far. He put his dash dial down and then picked his Y-wing dials back up.
Isn't that how it goes? You're always second-guessing yourself and rethinking things. But at an event like this, you want to obviously put your best maneuvers forward, and so they're taking a lot of time to think it over.
Yep, absolutely. I mean, I get caught doing this too, and I know it's happened to me where I'll set my dials down because I've decided it's the best course of action. Then I'll see my opponent either take a little longer or even maybe pick one of his dials up to change it. And then all of a sudden, I think I need to change my dial now. Not like I knew what he had before, but now that he's changing it, obviously I need to do something different.
So how is it different flying at a competitive event like this versus casual play? Do you have a different approach for the two different styles?
Personally for me, when it comes to competitive play, I absolutely need to know the list I'm flying. A lot of times, and Lyle here is displaying our new, that is the gold squadron promo card that has been crafted here by Paul LaRue. And every participant here in today's tournament, all 120 players got our gold squadron Paul LaRue card. And if you didn't see it there real quick, it's actually a art image of Y-Wings ionizing the Star Destroyer to disable it from Rogue One.
Man, one of the best scenes in any Star Wars movie, that entire battle sequence. And to have that depicted on a card is just tremendous.
And if anyone is familiar with Paul LaRue's artwork, it is amazing. His artwork in general and this card. So I am don't mean to make you guys jealous out there, but it's pretty awesome, and we all got one here.
Absolutely.
So yeah, back to the competitive view. You got to know the list you're flying. And I know in the competitive sense, when you're in the game, every move counts, and you're really spending more time focusing and critically analyzing. You know, in a casual play, I'll say, I'll do this, see how it works out for me, and learn from it. You know, you don't have that learning opportunity here. You know, right now to make the top 16, you're going to have to go X and 1 or better. I would be surprised, unless it breaks out differently than I'm expecting, that a 4 and 2 player will make it, especially now that we have no buys and no draws. So you know, every game matters, every move matters right now, and that's why this initial combat phase is huge for him. And it's nerve-wracking, especially in round one. You know, I know for me personally, you get into rounds two, three, and four, you kind of get loosened up. One of my first competitive events, I was so nervous that when we took the lunch break, I went out and had a beer and came back and felt better for it. Sometimes you just got to find your own way to calm your nerves down.
That's right.
And you'll see it in some of the players that you play. You know, my hand shakes when we start getting into the early rounds of a tournament. We all want to do our best. We're all here to have fun, but, you know, there's a reason why 120 players showed up today.
Absolutely. And so we're still setting dials here. They're really thinking this over. You have to pay attention to the clock, too, in competitive play.
Yeah, unfortunately, we couldn't get it on the screen, but we are at 54 minutes left in the round of this 75-minute round. So over 20 minutes gone so far, and no dice rolls yet. It looks like we got 5 of 6 dials down. It looks like Lyle's just deciding on Fen Rao right now.
Yeah, especially with all the repositioning that Fen Rao can do, there's a lot of decisions to make to put yourself in the best position to, again, control range and make sure you're not putting yourself in a bad spot.
And we had $5 down, and we're down to 2. But not to fault these guys, this is exactly how I play, especially in this when you know the engagement's looming. You have to. You have to make calculated moves. And if you lose, and when you lose, you want to tell yourself you flew the best you could, you know. Obviously, we all are going to make mistakes in any game, but you don't want to make a mistake because you rushed.
Yeah, and in a game like X-Wing, a single turn could change the course of the game. You know, if one turn goes badly or someone ends up on an obstacle or ends up bumping at the wrong time, that could spell disaster for that player. So there's a lot of things to consider, and I understand these players being very careful.
Too many times you've seen it where a game comes down to one die roll, and if games are that close that they're down to one die roll, then like you said, clipping an asteroid, getting into range one and when it should have been range two would change the game significantly.
Oh, that's all the difference right there.
Johnny, I have a little information for us. I just had a little birdie tell us the mobile firing arc is pointed to the left on Saj right now.
All right. Just as we thought. And so I think you'll see Saj here maybe continue to go straight and keep that mobile firing arc pointed towards where Jake's ships are likely to end up and be able to fire and spread those stress tokens.
And that's a range 1 to 2 ability, correct?
That's right. Yeah, range 1 to 2 inside the mobile firing arc.
We're back to 5 dials down. Fen is still undecided. Oh.
Rethinking manner. And you have to pay attention, too, to the order that the ships are going to move in. Those Y-wings are kind of tucked behind Dash. You want to make sure that you still get actions for the Y-wings. Here we're getting the movement started, but paying attention to the order. And it looks like he is maybe just going to tip forward and bump into Dash, another way to control range there. But these are all the options that they were working through.
You know, I think this was a good decision. I was wondering what the Y-Wings were going to do, thinking they might try to go charging past Dash. And then as the other ships move in, Dash probably gets into a bump situation. You know, with TLTs, you It's nice to have a focus token, but you don't need it.
It's not necessary. Yeah, that's true. And it looks like that other Y-Wing did a bank there to also bump into his friend.
Yep.
And now we have Manaru turning away from the action. So finally we have Lyle here trying to maybe protect Manaru a little bit. Obviously still able to shoot out of the 360-degree arc. But Manaru is now facing away. And we'll see what he ends up doing with Fenn. If Fenn is just going to bump into Manaru to stay back, or if Ben is going to fly straight to kind of move faster.
Yeah, that's very interesting. That's almost like a bait and switch with Manaru. Like, I'm bringing it into combat, and then I'm not.
Yeah, and with that 360-degree arc, you can still take shots, and obviously with her pilot ability, still be able to fast.
Did he clip that rock with
it? It looks like he might have. But
he gets to ignore it as far as his actions, but he's not going to be shooting this round. This is where he really needed engine upgrade to get off that rock. We're going to get a roll here for the rock. Hopefully. I hear dice shaking. Oh, never mind. Dash doesn't have to roll for a rock. He gets to ignore that.
That's right. Yeah, during the activation phase, that's
but
true.
He would get an ability, an action still, right?
Yeah, I believe so. Ignores obstacles during the activation phase and when performing actions.
Huh.
So maybe he's considering here.
Oh, barrel off the rock to get a shot?
That's right.
Again, great spot to have engine upgrade on if you had it.
That's right. But with the natural barrel roll, that should help things. People on the Twitch stream are saying he needs a barrel roll here, needs to move off of that asteroid. And so we'll see. I'm guessing that's what Jake is considering right now. Because he probably has the option to barrel roll either direction. It looks like he might have enough room there on the left to be able to fit behind that asteroid.
Yeah, if he can fit that template, and it'll go up half his base.
It's hard to tell from this angle if he can actually fit in there.
No, I can't. I hit a rock. Your dash.
Oh.
Oh my God! All right, that's what we've been dancing around. Okay, all right, yeah, right.
Oh,
sorry.
He didn't know what he.
Go ahead.
Jake didn't actually know he could do an action there. Lyle was waiting for Jake to do something, and Lyle being the formal guy he was, he didn't want to move his ship because he didn't want to take his action away from Jake.
Politely waiting. Okay, so now it looks like they've got it straightened out. And we'll figure out what's going on.
I think if Jake knew that, he might have been able to hesitate and think a little bit longer about the barrel roll-off, but...
Yeah, it looks like he just grabbed a token.
Threw it down there, yeah. Nice of Lyle to wait and then actually inform his opponent that there was still an ability for him to do.
That's right. Looks like there's a little bit of confusion here, but these players are both being nice and friendly to each other, which is that's what you like to see.
I think we're going to see some dire rolls in this combat phase. Looks like Manaru's going to have a range 3 shot on Dash, and Asajj probably range 3 shot at least on one of the Y-Wings.
Yeah, and then the Y-Wing will get to shoot back at Asajj, most likely.
Probably both of them. Tough to judge range here on the screen, but...
I'm always surprised how far range 3 is. You see two ships that look like they're miles apart, and you throw the range ruler down and find out that they're still within range 3. So it's very possible that that Y-Wing will have a TLT shot on Asajj. We'll see once shots are fired.
So if you lose scoring at home, the first die roll are coming at 45 minutes and 5 seconds remaining in the game.
So let's see, you're on the rock.
Obviously that one activation phase took a bit of time, but now that we're engaging, we'll see if things can pick up a little bit.
I know, I had a brain fart.
No, you're on the rock.
I could have failed.
Yeah, you got to roll for it.
Is Lyle...
Yeah, I think maybe we saw a roll for the asteroid there, which Dash should not have to do, but I think the result was no damage anyway.
Okay, hopefully no harm, no foul. So some inoptimal play here. You hear Lyle in the background. Nice having the table mic. Forgetting an action, Jake being kind and letting him pass the focus tokens that he wanted to pass.
It happens, dude.
It's just the jitters. I was like,
I know, dude.
Just thinking.
So this is Asajj shooting at one of the lead Y-Wings. We're going to try and reset our dice camera here. It appears our dice camera has locked up on us.
All right, so now we have Manaru shooting at Dash, I believe.
We really apologize here. After all this waiting and waiting, our dice camera, of course, went on the haywire here. We're gonna walk. I'm gonna walk over to the table, Johnny, and ask him to roll in the
spend and
roll on the mat for us.
All righty.
Next one.
So we're back to dials here. We have a runner out checking to see what the results of that round were. We'll get the lists on the side updated as soon as we get that information. But obviously that turn went pretty well for Lyle, with Dash not being able to shoot. And so we'll see how he can recover in these next few rounds. All right, bear with us while we work through some of these technical difficulties. We're trying to get the dice box back on camera. But in the meantime, looks like dials are being set here. We have those Y-Wings continuing to slow roll and keep their TLT range alive, trying to stay at range 3. and it looks like the back Y wing is going to do a bank there. So both of these Y wings will be able to take actions.
It froze, and now it won't come back on.
And we'll see what Manaru does here. If Manaru is going to kind of turn away and flee towards the front of the board. Nope, it looks like Manaru is turning in, so but still staying towards the edge. A good way to protect Manaru, and no bump there, so Manaru will be able to take a focus action and pass focus to everyone else. Or maybe Manaru is measuring there for a target lock. We'll have to see. Yeah, Manaru goes for the target lock. So Manaru will be relying on focus tokens from the rest of the squad through a Tani Mind Link and be able to take a fully modified focus target lock shot when combat comes.
I'm going to try the old one.
Yeah, we're trying to get our dice box camera so we can see the dice rolls. That camera froze up on us, so we are trying to get that back online. Okay, now we have Dash barrel rolling, trying to get into a better position here. Maybe going for a block on Fenrau. We'll have to see where Fenrau ends up. Obviously, Manaru is still in a good spot to take some shots on Dash. Dash, of course, will be able to shoot Manaru as well. And here we have Fenrau. Fenrau going for a bank maneuver that looks like it's going to bump. We'll see as both these players hold, put a finger down on their ships to try to keep them in place. And it looks like Fenrau does indeed bump there. So no repositioning for Fenrau.
I'll take it. Oh. Okay. All right, return fire attack. I got a bonus. No, good question, actually. Yeah, I am going to spend a lot.
Alright. Thank you.
mean, that's... Oh, wait, yeah, actually, it should have been Sash first.
Oh, before dash, yeah. It's not going to matter. I'm going to switch my arc.
Okay. I couldn't do this.
boxes on the ship.
Darwin is up, trying the camera out. We'll get it back up and running as soon as we can. Check, check, check.
Test.
It was the new dice camera?
Seems like it.
Okay.
That's the only thing that changed. All right. Sounds like we're back here. We had some issues with the dice camera interfering with our microphone feed.
You can shut that down, and I will give a... I'll call you with an update on damage.
Okay, and Darwin is going to go check out the damage report, and we'll get that updated as soon as we can. Again, sorry for the issues here, but we looks like we've got it mostly sorted out. And as people on the chat have pointed out, everything is kind of... tucked into the corner here, so we'll see how both players get out of this situation. All right, I'm going to get the damage numbers updated here. Fenrau is still at full health. Manaru has no shield, full hull. And Asajj has no shield, 6 hull. And for Jake's list, Dash is full. One of the Y-Wings is gone. And the second Y-Wing is still full. And it looks like actually Dash here is down to 1 shield. All right, so these players have kind of flown themselves into a corner here. Who's in a good spot, and who's going to be having some trouble getting out of this situation? Looks like Dash is kind of stuck there by Manaru. See if he's going to be able to get out of that.
Yeah, Dash. Does Dash have a... Well, I guess Manaru has to move first. He's almost going to have to do a one hard... looks like there is a little bit more board than our camera's showing, so there's a little more space there than meets the eye.
Yeah, maybe a 3-speed maneuver will just kind of get around that whole thing.
Yep. There is 19 minutes left. Looks like 1 hit coming in.
Yeah. And I think we have Asajj shooting out of the mobile firing arc on that Y-wing.
I actually think that was the Y-wing shooting at Asajj.
Okay.
And the second TLT shot looks like this one's going to do damage.
Yeah.
Two dice. Can't evade it. So Asajj is going to take another damage. So it looks like Asajj is going to be down to 5 hull now. And that Y-wing looked like it lost one shield. So I think one thing important here is with 17 minutes remaining, you're starting to think points. He just got it to half on Asajj.
That's true. Yeah, so that's a big deal.
One more hit point on Manaru and also takes Manaru down to half.
Yeah, and we have Dash here almost at half, and that Gold Squadron pilot taken off the board.
Yeah, 24 points right there, so... So if you're scoring at home right now, Lyle has 24 points. And Jake having half on Asajj is 20 points. So if it ended right now, Lyle wins.
That's right. It's a very, very close game, very close spot. I could see why these players were both very careful. You have that Y-wing now kind of turning away. I'm not sure if the Y-wing is going to get shots here. Maybe on Fenrau, actually, depending on where Fenrau ends up.
I think Fen might be chasing a Y-wing to eat it for lunch here.
Yeah, that's a very good matchup in the favor of Lyle.
Just keeping you warmed up.
All right. I think we had a bump there with Manaru, and now we have Asajj moving into that corner. So everyone is partying there in the corner. We'll see where Dash ends up moving.
It's almost like he's going to force Manaru to stay in the same spot, because Manaru's not going to have a legal move now, forcing Dash to stay in the same spot.
Well, and I think, is that, did they call it there?
Yeah, I would appear to be. Did
it looks like we have a GG here with 15 minutes to go. I'm surprised these players didn't keep playing it out, but...
Was Dash flying off the board? I mean, maybe that 3-speed took him off the board. Was that the issue?
Oh, that's a good point. I'm not sure. We'll get some information here and try to figure out what happened. But that is the game. We'll try to find out if we had a ship flying off the board. Obviously, if Dash goes off the board, that is... more than half of Jake's list in terms of points, so that would be pretty devastating. But yeah, both players here cleaning up a very close game right there until the end. In terms of points, both players are pretty evenly matched. And then just one wrong move turns the tide.
So we do have an update from the table. Jake had said that his 3 bank he was hoping was going to keep him on the board, and it actually took him off the board.
Oh, man.
So when we saw that template go down, that was pretty much the
end.
They
were determining that it was going off. Okay.
Yeah, and with Dash gone, he was going to be having that lone Y-wing that was probably going to be chased down by Fen. So a little surprised us, but... I did speak with Lyle just for a moment. He did exactly what we thought. He was using Asajj to force Manaru into having no legal move.
Right,
so Manaru stayed and then had to block, and then blocked and locked in Dash.
Yeah, so good ship placement there on Lyle's part, and forcing Dash into a tough situation, really, that made the game.
It sure did. Definitely, we hear it a lot. You don't want to fly into a corner. It kind of happened in that game, and looks like Lyle got the best of it.
Yeah, I was saying it was a close game right up there until the end. In terms of points, very evenly matched, and really could have gone either way, with Dash still able to land some heavy laser cannon hits, and Manaru almost down to half hole. It could have gone either way, but one bad move and that's it.
Like we said, it was a 4-point game going into that move, that turn, and one unfortunate maneuver, end of the game for one of the players.
Yeah, that's how it goes.
Well, we'll take a pause here. Thanks for listening. Thanks for going through our technical difficulties with us. We're going to get this dice camera back working and in action. And we'll bring you more in round two. And I hope we'll have some new matchups and some new lists to talk about, Johnny.
All right. We'll see you guys shortly.